Já não caímos na velha história. Saímos para combater a escória. Ladrões, corruptos, gritem comigo para essa gente ir embora. Gritem comigo, pois o povo já não chora.
Isto é Maputo, ninguém sabe bem como. O povo contém dormia hoje, perdeu o sono.
The research actually asked the question, why do people protest? What brings people out to protest about food issues, particularly in that period, 2007 to 2012, that we were interested in. And we wanted to know not only what motivated people to come out, what people's reasons were, but also what brought them together, what made them act collectively. The other thing we wanted to really understand is what kinds of responses did their mobilisation elicit from the policy elites they were targeting with their demonstrations, with their actions.
Contemporary food riots are both the same and different from those in the past. Food riots are still shaped by those political relationships among rioters and between rioters and their rulers. For instance, in 2008, Egyptian food rioters drew on the strength of their trade union movement to defend their access to food, even in the authoritarian regime of Hosni Mubarak. By contrast, in India, their vital democracy means that there are relatively few food riots, and instead, food politics, the right to food, works through social movements like the right to food movement that hold governments accountable.
I think the most important contribution of the right to food campaign in India has been to make the notion of right to food a very mainstream notion in society. Because if you look back 10, 15, 20 years ago, the acceptance of the right to food as a fundamental right which every citizen should have access to, and where the state is the principal duty bearer or has the principal obligation to fulfill, was not accepted. And so therefore in this journey I think we've come a very long way in not only getting acceptance in society at large, but also having parliament legislate an act which makes the right to food a fundamental act.
I think India still quite a bit of a distance away from making the right to food a reality for all Indians. But what has happened over the last 5 to 10 years, and I think the right to food campaign has contributed greatly to it, is to make it a public issue, make it an issue that people debate and talk about, that newspapers cover hunger and malnutrition. And we have a National Food Security Act now, which was passed just 6 months back.
So when we set up this study, we wanted to take an urban area, so Nairobi, a neighborhood of Nairobi, Mathare, very poor area, and take a rural area where we knew that, you know, food is an issue. So we picked a relatively dry area of the country where there'd been food shortage cyclically for about 3 years, and yet we hadn't seen any reports in the media of any unrest there. So our question was, you know, why is it that one area where there's stress, you see the kind of mobilization around food, yeah, protests and all that, in an area where, another area where we know that there's a food problem, we haven't seen any mobilization. But when we got there, actually, when we began to talk to people, we realized that there has been protest, just not the kind of protest that attracted national media, right? And it tended to be sporadic. So it will happen in response to specific issues, mostly to do with irregular practice by local administrators in the distribution of the relief food.
We think that a degree of food justice is foundational for states in contemporary developing countries. You have to have it in order for a state to be legitimate, to have authority to run itself on a day-to-day basis, to reproduce itself on an everyday basis. It needs to be able to assure people a basic minimum level of food security, and at the same time, food justice, a sense that if I'm going hungry, it's not because somebody else is benefiting from that. The thing that people find completely intolerable is that when they're facing shortages and they're facing hardship, they're unable to feed their families, when their children are going hungry, that somebody else is making a profit from that. That is really the thing that is unacceptable to people.
The food rioters of 2008 could not reach the big powers of the neoliberal global food system, that is, big agribusiness corporations or those American food farm blocks, which tilt the food system in their direction. But on the other hand, the food riots of 2008 did make the World Bank and the United Nations change their paradigms about the global food system. Whether that puts food in people's stomach remains to be seen.
O povo é que está no poder.